What is wealth? Throughout the series, we'll be running a brief segment on what is wealth. It compares Fred and John's financial affairs to help us see if we can determine what an accurate definition of wealth might be. I think you might be surprised. So here is the first episode of What is Wealth? Fred is a self-employed computer technician. The businesses whose equipment Fred looks after feels he's indispensable. So clearly, Fred is talented at what he does. The nature of small business, however, is that Fred is only indispensable at his current charge-out rate. Every time he increases the rate, he loses a contract or two, so his income remains reasonably static. This means that irrespective of Fred's talents, he earns about $90,000 a year. This doesn't worry Fred too much. He enjoys what he does, and he'd probably work for nothing, well, at least for his nicer clients. Fred is also developing a software application he thinks is a bit ahead of the market, but a cancelled contract allows him more time to bring his product to the market, hopefully before the competition. Fred lives on the wrong side of the city. He has to drive both to and from work with the sun in his eyes. Fred has a 3-bedroom Edwardian solid brick home, which is about 6 kilometres from the general post office of the city. Fred's home is worth about $570,000. John works as a merchant banker. He's well regarded in his profession. John has recently finalised a couple of deals, which the bank quite liked, so he's been promoted to associate. As an associate, John has achieved a more stable income. He earns $418,000 per year. The stability is achieved by structuring a high base salary. Whilst it's vaguely possible for John to increase his income with performance bonuses, it's unlikely as the KPI, key performance indicators, are set very high. Of course, John lives on the best side of the city, in the best suburb on the best side of the city. Nothing too flashy, but his 3-bedroom Edwardian solid brick home is worth still about $1.5 million. John's home is also 6 kilometres from the city centre. I'm joined by Dale Brilley again from Mercury Wealth Management. Dale is going to help us tease out this final issue in goals. Dale, thank you for joining us again.
No problem, Kerry.
Dale, do you have clients who have had a difficult time with their finances because they didn't actually create goals, and can you tell us something about that?
I've had a lot of clients where you actually bring up the idea of goal setting and they either struggle with the short-term goals, so the 1 to 2 year goals, or the very long-term goals, which is 3 to 5 years plus. They seem to either have a short-term desire that they know what they want to do by the end of the year, and that's fine, but they have no actual longer-term goals where they struggle for, or they know the big picture, but they actually don't know how to actually get to that point in time 5 years plus down the track.
Okay, I guess everyone's goal is to succeed, but in speaking about how a building turns from a hole in the ground to something that's actually functional and useful, we developed the concept of actually having to write goals down and understand them. Is that the trouble that the clients have experienced in that area in your view?
Oh, definitely. You actually ask them to put down maybe even 20 goals. Sometimes we actually lengthen it out to maybe a 100 goal challenge for them to do. And they get to maybe 5 to 10, which are the simple ones, which are really like the everyday things, buy your own house, pay off your mortgage, or start a family. But when you actually nut it down to some more definitive ones that they actually would like to achieve personally, a lot of clients in particular just seem to struggle with that area.
Okay. Going on the other side, the clients who have had goals, how has that made a difference to their financial affairs?
Oh, a massive difference, Kerry. Basically, if you've got a set goal, for example, a client that is really struggling with debt and wants to pay it off, and it's their number one focus, and that's all they really are focusing on going forward for maybe the 6 to 12 month period, they really know where they want to go and how to achieve it. I guess the next step is, once they do achieve that, is to reset the goals going forward again.
Yeah, that's true. Now, you spoke about 100 goals earlier. You've done 100 goals yourself, haven't you?
Yeah, I've done 100 goals. The key to that is, and I'll be honest, I struggled probably after about 50 or so, and the last probably 10 are a bit wishy-washy, but you actually need to revisit those goals. What I've found is that if you don't sit back, and you can actually be surprised the amount of goals you do tick off. Some you can tick off quite easily, the rest you work on, but just revisit them every 3 to 4 months to see how you're tracking against those 100 goals you have set.
As you know, we did 100 goals together. I reviewed my 100 Goals First client seminar and found that I'd completed 87 of them in the year. And I was incredibly surprised about that. I probably would have done more if I'd reviewed it.
Yeah.
Dale, finally, we get clients who have goals, but they don't seem to reflect what they actually want to do. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
It's the stereotypical goals about, I want to have the 3-bedroom, 2-bathroom house, or I want to travel all around the world by the age of 30. It's the things that they either read about in the media, or they've heard a friend or a family member have done, and they think that's a great idea. They're not actually personalised goals, so it's actually not reflecting what their actual wishes are. They obviously might want to travel, but it might be a shorter term thing where they only want to travel to one country, so you might need to condense that down rather than just saying, I need to travel all around the world, which is a general goal a lot of people have, but you might want to then break that goal down to countries. So they might actually have a specific country that they'd like to visit first and then go from there.
So you're saying that an adoptive goal should be broken down to in a way that can make it personal?
Yeah, exactly. Some clients may have a reason for traveling to America, for example, because they've got family over there, or they've had a goal to travel there, but they might just use the generic one where I want to just travel.
Yes.
It's not a specific goal. You need to have a specific target in mind, and maybe that could be a country if we're using the traveling as an example, or you could have another one, as I've said previously, which is paying down debt, and then you need to break that down into which debt you want to pay off.
Okay. The adopted goals, are they useful or are they an impediment to people achieving success?
I think it's a starting point, but unless you actually sit down and review them, and again, we talked about putting it on paper, it is an impediment, because if you don't have a set target, you won't achieve it. So general goals are fine, but you then need to review them and put them down into a more condensed item. So if you don't do the process, it will be an impediment, but if you actually have a broad range of ideas, it's a good starting point, but you really need to drill down that area a bit further.
Okay, thank you very much indeed, Dale.
No problem,
Kerry.
We'll
be seeing you again in the next show, I think.
Yeah, I think so.
Good. The situation is that any goal is a good goal. If it's your goal, it's even better, and if it's written down and reviewed, it's even better again. Don't forget our competition. Please go to the website and sign up for our 100 Goal Challenge. Prizes are being generously awarded by AIA Australia, who are giving a free risk assessment away every week, and 2 iPads to be won throughout the series. And also Keith Abraham, who's donated his book about finding your passion. Go to the website wealthplan.tv. Thank you for joining us on Wealth Plan TV. I hope you enjoyed the show. Next week, we'll be dealing with outs and ins, the issues concerning cash flow.